Hello, Internet. Jazza here. Today we're gonna, like, chill out a little bit. I've been talking about quite a lot of serious topics recently, and quite frankly, my brain is frazzled. So I thought that today we'd be able to talk about movies, if you're okay with that. My friend Rowan recently did a video talking about her favourite LGBT movies coming out this year, starting with the likes of Moonlight, but then going through a load of really kind of interesting indie movies that you probably haven't heard of that are coming out in 2017. I thought that I would do something similar to that, but talk about the movies, the LGBT movies, that are like kind of quirky, obscure, you've probably not heard of them before, so that when you're in your like queer safe spaces and you're chatting about how brilliant Moonlight was, you can whip out all of these fantastic examples of queer cinema and impress everyone. Look at me, I'm just like, give. I'm just gonna mention five really amazing LGBT movies that you probably haven't heard of, but that I think that you should go out and see. Sound good?
At some point, you gotta decide for yourself who you gonna be. Can't let nobody make that decision for you.
There has been, quite rightly, loads of praise and hype about how amazing Moonlight was, and it winning Best Picture at the Oscars was definitely deserved. Just a shame that that had to happen.
I'm sorry. No. There's a mistake. Moonlight, you guys won Best Picture. Moonlight won.
Something that you may not know about Moonlight is that the director, Barry Jenkins, has talked quite a lot about how influenced he was by a Hong Kongese director who I am also obsessed with called Wong Kar-wai. Wong has directed some beautiful, ridiculous movies. Lust Caution is one that was quite big in the international scene, but also stuff like Mood for Love, Chungking Express are phenomenal pieces of Asian cinema that are just, he's a brilliant director, an unconventional storyteller, and his cinematography and the way that he frames shots and the colour is just phenomenal. But if you specifically like Moonlight, then I would recommend that you went and watched Wong Kar-wai's Happy Together. This film was kind of like a closet door for me when I was growing up. It came out in 97. I think I watched it about 99, 2000. It started my lifelong obsession with Tony Leung and Leslie Cheung. And you can see all of the influences kind of seep through into what made Moonlight so cinematographically interesting from this film. Colours, the unconventional camera angles and the wonderful cinematography are all there, and you can see the influences that seeped through into a work like Moonlight. And this film, in a way that a lot of Wong Kar-wai films are, is about his two main characters, a gay couple that have moved to Argentina, them trying to find happiness both separately and together. And this film is really about kind of realizing about when you have to let go of love, even though the chemistry and the desire and your want to give your full self to somebody is there. If somebody treats you poorly, then you have to make some decisions in life. And this is an amazing, It's an amazing film. I just rewatched it and the end scene always makes me cry. So I would 100% recommend Happy Together. I next want to recommend you The Boys in the Band, which oddly is directed by the same director as The Exorcist, but thankfully is nothing like it. The film is based off of a screenplay that was on Broadway in the late 60s. This film was released in 1970. And it's really stunning how I don't want to say ahead of its time it was, because that's a real cliche, but how honest and true it was to the gay male experience, in that it showed a group of grown gay men kind of being catty and being like trapped in a space together, and all of them kind of projecting their own amount of self-loathing of the fact that they were gay onto each other, and wrestling with ideas of love and what was expected of them, both in the straight world, in the fake world that they lived in outside, and in this gay world that they inhabit within the four walls of this party that they're at. Couple of fun facts. There's one scene where it's the earliest example of a commentary on fragile masculinity that I've ever seen, when a couple of characters talk about male hairspray.
And also for you, something called control. Now, notice, nowhere on the label is it called hairspray, just simply control. And the words for men are written about 37 times all over the goddamn can.
Also, it is thought to be the first mainstream American film to extensively use the word cunt. Fun fact. This is ultimately a really sad film and resonated with me big time because I remember what it was like to not want to be gay, but to still be happier that I was, which sounds like a conflict of interests, but was so, like, it's such a familiar feeling, and I think that's why this film hits home.
You're stoned and you're late. You were supposed to arrive at this location at approximately 8:30-9 o'clock.
What I am, Michael, is a 32-year-old, ugly, pockmarked Jew fairy. And if it takes me a while to pull myself together, and if I smoke a little grass before I get up the nerve to show my face to the world, it's nobody's goddamn business but my own. And how are you this evening?
It is a play, so there's not a lot of very exciting cinematography in it, but the dialogue and the way it's written and the performances are outstanding. A lot of the cast that were on the Broadway version of this play reprise their roles in this movie. It's probably most well known for this little piece of dialogue that I'll leave you with. But yeah, if you haven't seen this film, watch this film.
You're a homosexual and you don't want to be. But there's nothing you can do to change it. Not all your prayers to your God. Not all the analysis you can buy in all the years you've got left to live. You may very well one day be able to know a heterosexual life, if you want it desperately enough. If you pursue it with the fervor with which you annihilate. But you'll always be homosexual as well. Always, Michael. Always. Until the day you die.
Quickly before I go on to the next film, right now, both of those are available to watch on YouTube, but shush, don't tell anybody. I'll link them in that little corner thing. Either it's there or it's there. Go, watch them quick. Luckily, the next film you can also watch relatively easily. It's called Game Face and is on Netflix at the moment. It's a documentary that follows two LGBT athletes as they go through their coming out process and the challenges that each of them respectively have to encounter when they go through this process.
Fallon Fox.
She is an MMA fighter.
It's not her undefeated record that has everyone talking.
She is a transgender female.
It's an advantage over a woman, you know?
It follows the stories of Terrence Clemens and Fallon Fox, both of whom started off in their respective sports, basketball and mixed martial arts, closeted. Clemens is a gay man and Fallon Fox is a trans gay woman. And I loved this film, this documentary, because when I was growing up, I had no real role models that I kind of identified with. And it's really humbling, especially when you live in a liberal bubble like myself now, to see how there are still parts of society that it is still incredibly hard to come out as trans or as gay. And both of these athletes had a huge amount of pushback. Both of these athletes had to deal with prejudice as they were coming out and were scared. But what is really amazing about this documentary is the support networks that both of these athletes have. And that is what really kind of like touches me. And is, if you want to feel warm and fuzzy, is definitely a documentary worth watching on Netflix if you have a spare hour and a half or so.
Merry Christmas Eve, bitch.
Tangerine is such a special film. So even if you... This film came out in like 2015, I think. And even if you completely ignore the fact that this whole film was shot on iPhone 5Ss, not even like the iPhone 6 when the camera got really good. This whole film was shot on iPhone 5Ss. He edited it in Final Cut Pro. And loads of the actors in the film had very little acting experience before this. They used real locations as much as possible. Even if you kind of ignore all of that, this film is so... like, it blindsides you. It's brilliant, because in like the first... like 10-15 minutes, there are these amazing like action shots that I can only really compare to like the moving cameras and the dynamism that you see in a film like Mad Max Fury Road, of like these panning shots around these characters as they're storming for like a goal of whatever their goal is that they're trying to get to, the place or the person that they're trying to find. And it's just, and the music is kind of like thumping and electronic, and I'm just like, like, it's such an experience to watch this film. In a similar way to Wong Kar-wai's Happy Together, this also has, like, the contrast has been really ramped up in a lot of the shots, and so you have these huge, beautiful contrasts in colour, and apparently that's why they called it, like, Tangerine, because when they upped the contrast, all of this LA Hollywood sky came out as, like, this bright orange tangerine colour, and it's so... it has such a dramatic... but also calming and beautiful ending that just really warms your heart and is a wonderful portrayal of the camaraderie and sisterhood that exists between trans sex workers in LA. And it really opens your eyes to kind of like the matter-of-factness of that world, but also kind of the dreams and hopes and aspirations that each of those individuals have themselves, whether that be the pursuit of love or the pursuit of being able to make art, or the pursuit of just being able to, like, pay the next paycheck. All of those themes are there, and you're there and invested in each and every single one of the characters. And I think this film is brilliant. Lucky enough, at the moment, it's also still available on YouTube for as long as that exists, so I'll link it in kind of like the information bar. But this, like, if you haven't seen Tangerine, watch Tangerine. Are you seeing a theme with all of the films that I am giving you? I think you should watch them.
Come on,
shut the fuck up.
You're not even hard yet.
Fucking hard, shut up.
That's hard.
One final film before I get onto a couple of honourable mentions. How to Survive a Plague. I don't want to exaggerate and say it changed my life, but this really put into perspective what it would have been like for me had I been born 10 years earlier. It tracks the AIDS epidemic and the group of gay men who were all kind of part of the movement to try and get treatment and research for people who were infected with HIV and suffering with AIDS. And there were a couple of things about this film. First of all, that the AIDS epidemic only started to be taken seriously and started to get airtime when white, educated, rich men started getting infected with the virus. This had existed in like the sex industry and in communities of colour for years before it kind of like hit mainstream gay culture, and was kind of ignored even more so than it was when it was when it came to be known as like the gay plague. And these people, who the people documented in this documentary, are mostly incredible, like Ivy League educated, white, handsome men who are palatable for an American audience.
There are over 140 drugs out there that the FDA has identified as possibilities and are in some stage of being looked at right now.
Why are they
holding back? Among that 140, there's got to be one or a combination thereof that can slow down this virus or halt it in its tracks.
You're just simply carrying the virus, is that correct?
I have a few very minor symptoms and my immune system is virtually shot.
And there's a reason that that's the case, because the media is racist. But it is so interesting to see how many people were excluded from this battle to combat HIV when my community was so ravaged by it. It's also really humbling for me, because I don't know about those of you who are younger, but I was born in the 80s. I was born in 1989, at the height of, maybe not the height, but like one of the scariest times to be a gay man in the world. And so the 80s for me don't feel like this ancient distant time. And God, this plague that was killing people left, right, and center. It's such a recent part of LGBT history. And I think and we as a community should not forget that. And because these things don't generally get taught in schools, at least not yet, we'll work on that. We need to make sure that we educate ourselves about the, like, how shit it was to be queer not so long ago.
Plague! We are in the middle of a fucking plague! And you behave like this! Plague! 40 million infected people is a fucking plague!
A couple of honourable mentions. First off, Pride is a British comedy movie, touching, sweet, funny, it's amazing. It's about a group of gay people who team up with miners under Margaret Thatcher's Britain and start kind of like what we now see is like the Pride movement and this whole tradition of protesting in the LGBT community. And it's really it's such a fantastically told story in such an entertaining way, and has a load of amazing British acting heavyweights in the cast, and is such an important reminder of that if you want something, then you bloody well have to inconvenience yourself and fight for it. It's a brilliant film, you should watch it. If you really, really liked Happy Together, then you should watch the British movie The Weeknd, which is a really touching movie about, spoiler alert, a weekend spent with a gay couple that starts a one-night stand and end up falling in love over a weekend. And it's really similar to Wong Kar-wai films in that the characters are given a opportunity to be happy, but will they take that opportunity? Who knows? And then I want to give you the iconic lesbian movie from France, Blue is the Warmest Colour. I would watch the film because the film is iconic, but make sure that you read the graphic novel that it's based on as well. It's also brilliant. Thank you so much for watching. This film. I am now a filmmaker. This video is made possible by my patrons who help me to keep this channel going. It's sometimes, especially nowadays, really difficult to make any money off of YouTube, and you guys make this that much easier. Thank you to the guys whose names are scrolling across the screen. Thank you. Please let me know if you think I have missed any standout films that are kind of like a little bit off the beaten track. Obviously, Paris is Burning isn't on this list, because I feel like most people have seen Paris is Burning now. Although, feel free to drag me in the comments for not including it. But I would love to do more of these like queer pop culture recommendation lists. I've already done books, which you can watch on this channel. But maybe I'll do TV shows or like comics and things like that. Could be fun. If you want to see more queer shit, then subscribe. That's my face. But also, watch this next video. YouTube already thinks that you'll like it because it's all seeing eye. The algorithm has determined it so. So enjoy seeing that as well. Right. Goodbye.